give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, labor of love, and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of our God and Father. Knowing, beloved brethren, your election by God, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men you were, we were in you for your sake. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became examples of all in Macedonia and Achaia who believed. For from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out, so that we do not need to say anything. For they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had in you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living God and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, and even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Thankful for the journey. Thankful for the journey. Please join me in prayer. Lord, I want to thank you. We talk about Thanksgiving, Lord, but I want to start out by just saying we thank you. We thank you for all you do, for all you speak, for all you show us, for everything you are. We thank you. We have a great God who is greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Touch our hearts, Lord, as we take this journey today. May it be a picture of the journey that we take day in and day out with you, with the Holy Spirit, with the leading of your Holy Word. Help us, dear God, to see this is not just a matter of looking through a Bible. This is a matter of seeing how much you love us and how much you give us, dear God, to lead us in the direction that you want us to go. Praise the Lord. You've got a journey for each and every one of us. And I thank you, dear God, for the call today to truly open up and let that journey go deeper and deeper and continue, and you will have the glory. Yes, Lord, it will be your glory. Hallelujah, dear God. It's because you are a loving God, a caring God, a God that is full of grace and mercy and truth. And I want to thank you for that, dear God. Lord, this is a thankful house. Lord, we must be a thankful house. And I believe that's true of every one of our homes. We need to be a thankful house in these last of days. Help us, dear God, to be that even right now today. Be very, very thankful, dear God, for all that you show us and all that you give us and every step you have us take. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Is there any other way to put it? Is there any other way to say it? We are thankful. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We give you the glory. We praise your holy name. And we do need you. And we know there are a lot of other people in this world who need you. So they need to see you living and working in us. Hallelujah. And that is something we can be thankful about. So we just give you the glory today. And Lord, we thank you for the journey. Hallelujah. Thankful for the journey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Checking my little list here to make sure I'm not missing. It is said back in the early days of television, when Milton Berle, and you've all heard of him, you've seen him on various shows, I imagine he's passed away by now, but I don't remember hearing about it. But anyway, he would be quite elderly if he was still around. But he was considered Mr. Television. That's what they called him. He was about the only thing on. Well, not quite. But, you know, he was right there at the forefront as television really got its start. And that was on Tuesday nights. However, there was a bishop. His name was Sheen. Bishop Sheen, who the story says eclipsed the star. Eclipsed the star. That is, his religious program, which I'm not sure I never saw it, but was it a religious program? Was it a service or just what was it? But anyway, it turns out that he kind of got ahead in the ratings, so to speak, of Milton Berle. Milton Berle, by the way, went by the nickname Uncle Milty. So original, right? All right. Well, Berle met Sheen shortly after being replaced as number one by the bishop and graciously congratulated him. Bishop Sheen is reported to have replied, "I don't deserve all the credit. I just have better writers than you do." All right? Berle, who was well known for being Jewish, laughed, and Bishop added, "Don't feel too bad, Milty. Most of my writers are nice Jewish boys." All right? See, we're talking about the Bible. Amen? We're talking about the Word of God. Hallelujah. I'm sure you know that there are lots and lots of uses for the Bible, and people do choose different ones, not always the best ones for them, but one use is to collect dust on the coffee table. That's a popular one, all right? Some people use it basically just to, and you can have flowers. I have a lily from the flower arrangement for Cindy's funeral. I have it pressed and laminated, and it's in my Bible. But that's not all I use my Bible for. Amen. Do you hear what I'm saying? You can keep flowers in there. You can keep newspaper clippings. You can keep bookmarks and so forth and so on. Okay? But the real purpose, of course, is the Word of God. Amen? Would you believe there's one woman who declared that she keeps her household money there? Money that she has for going grocery shopping or going to Walmart or whatever it might be, she keeps her money in her Bible. I don't know whether it's her Bible she used, periodically or whenever, or whether it was a big family Bible, I don't know. And she said she did that because the people who would open her Bible, okay, would not be the type to steal it from you. Somebody opening the Bible would not be a thief, or, supposedly. And the ones who would possibly steal it won't open it in the first place. Right? So what are we talking about here? Well, we're talking about the Bible. We're talking about the Word of God. Something we can certainly be very thankful for. Amen? Now, I want to take you on a journey here today. It's not going to be comprehensive. It's not going to be exhaustive. But I want to take you through Cindy's Bible. For the sake of anybody hearing this or watching this, I have to give a little bit of explanation of what I'm talking about, though you know all about it. Cindy, my wife, she spent the most of the last 2 years in a nursing home with the end stages of Alzheimer's and several months of COVID-19 restrictions. No visitors for several months, except for those who would sit outside her window looking through her window. And I remember I had a little PA system we have. I took that and I would go ahead and try to be loud so that she could hear through the window. That didn't put the sound in her room, but it was loud outside the window, and then she could she could hear that. And then we also used walkie-talkies. Now, she wasn't speaking in the last several months, so she didn't need to press a button. So we just, pressed it so it was on, and then I could speak to her. Now she's got sound in the room, okay? And that's if it works. And that's if the battery doesn't run out, okay? We had all kinds of issues along the way. Well, finally our family was allowed into the nursing home due to her failing health. And I'm very, very glad. I am very thankful that I believe the Lord led us to then bring her home and to have her there at the house. Amen. Very glad we brought her home, and that was under hospice supervision, and things worked out quite smoothly. But that only went for about a week and a half. And on Sunday, as many of you, if not all of you, will remember, August 23rd, she went to be in the ever-loving arms of her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Did you know that Cindy was born on the Lord's Day? She died then, too. Hospice nurse didn't get there till after midnight, so the official time of death is early Monday morning, but that's not really what happened. She passed away on Sunday, okay, late in the day. Born on the Lord's Day, died on the Lord's Day. At her service, I think I mentioned it to you, I did not use my own Bible. I used her Bible. Okay? Remember? It's not as black as mine. Not as big as mine. It was her Bible. Amen? And praise God for that. Praise God for that. I was struck by how much, this is even before the service, even before she passed away, I've always been struck by how much the Lord was speaking to her through a lot of different avenues and a lot of different things. She has literally thousands of definitions written in her margins from the Greek and from the Hebrew. Okay, she has many handwritten quotes and definitions that were pasted and taped to many of the inside pages, you know, the blank pages at the beginning and the end, and then also on the inside cover, okay? It was a Bible that I had rebound. What date did I tell you? It says right here, she even wrote it down. September 28th, 01. Huh. That's almost a year later than what I have here, which is February 29th, 2000. So, but this is when the Bible was done. It was in her hands. So maybe I'll run with that. Okay? The point is, it was hers. And she knew that God was speaking to her through these things. Just like God can speak to every one of you through your own Bibles. Amen? You don't have to fill them with glued on quotes or taped or writing in the margin. You know, you don't have to do all that to be on God's journey. You just seek the Lord and you'll be where He wants you. Do you hear me? I got to be real clear about this. I'm not sharing these things because I'm trying to put her up on some kind of pedestal. I don't need to do that. Okay? The main thing is to understand that that's available to everybody to be on that journey with God. Okay? So God has already got you on that journey. He's already speaking to you, you know, and it can be through your Bible. It can be through a devotional book. It can be through so many things. It can be through other things people say. It can be through other things people pray, like, you know, whether it's on a Friday night and we're praying, or you gather on Tuesday and Thursday and you pray. Well, guess what? That's part of the journey. Amen? So let's be thankful for that. Glory to God. Amen? Now this Bible was imprinted in gold on the front with her name, Cindy Lee Warren. On the side, it says Holy Bible in that gold leaf that you do that kind of thing with. Okay? Someone once said, I believe the Bible from cover to cover. I even believe the cover. Amen? Because what's God? There's you. There's your name. Okay? Not only that, you know what it is. Amen? It it's the Holy Bible. It's not just some list of suggestions. Amen? Praise the Lord. Okay? All right. Now, I'm not going to go through everything and actually show it to you, but I will show you this. This is on the inside cover, right here. First of all, it's a picture of all three jewels, as she used to call them. I call them munchkins, but she called them jewels, referring, of course, to Andrew, Ben, and Lily. And they're on a hike. Looks like they're on a road or on their, I don't think it's their driveway. Might be up at the industrial park or something. Anyway, and two of them are on scooters. And then there's, I'll bet it was the industrial park, because then Lily is crouched down in front of the pond with all the lily pads. Get it? Okay. Okay. And those are the, that starts out the book right there with those two pictures. All right. Now the first handwritten quote is from the Bible. The first one that's in her Bible is from the Bible. It's taken from Isaiah chapter 43. Now you really don't have to turn there because it's short. Isaiah 43 verses 10 and 11. Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe me, and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. Now, I didn't tell her to put that in there. The Lord showed her that needed to start the book off. That's the first quote, scriptural quote, excuse me, that she wrote in her Bible. Okay? Now we got to remember there's a whole lot of ground here, and there's just no way that I can do that, which is why I thought I'd just sit down with the kids for a couple of minutes and start at the back of the book. Well, you still don't get near covering it. And someday I want to do what Kathy was starting to do, and that is just page by page going through, seeing who she's praying for, seeing who she's, you know, what she's seeing from what God says and so forth. And that, you've got to hear me on this, that is available to one and all. It is available to each and every one of us. Amen? And we're on that journey. We've been in our Bibles. Like I said, you don't have to fill it with all kinds of stuff or anything if that's not what you choose to do. But praise God, you know, he can take you every step with this book. Amen? All right. I just want to be real clear about that. All right. She spent the mornings, 6 days a week, in prayer and studying the Bible. The seventh day, of course, was Sunday, and that was spent in Sunday school and church. One of her favorite authors, and is quoted several times in her Bible, was Amy Carmichael, missionary to India. All right? She had a nickname, and Amy Carmichael's nickname was Amma. A-M-M-A. It comes from the Hebrew. It's one of the words for mothering. It has to do with mothering. Not being the mother per se, but just, you know, caring about the kids, amen, and praying for them, and helping to show them Jesus, all that, okay? And when our grandkids came into this world, Cindy chose a variation of that Amma for her own nickname. It, too, is Amma, amen? But it was spelled differently. She spelled it A-M-A, okay? She didn't want to take from the other, but she still wanted that. Okay? My choice was Papa, and that wasn't near as spiritual. Okay. Anyway, did you know that I was born on the very day that Amy died? Not just date or day of the week, but the very day, the very 24-hour period that she died, I was born. I always felt somewhat of a spiritual connection with that. Doesn't prove anything, doesn't mean anything necessarily. Yeah, Lily. Carmichael, she lived her closing years in bed. I don't know if you knew this. She had been injured quite severely. She was in a severe fall in her compound, her organization's compound, Donovan Fellowship. And that fellowship, that place in India, is still going on today, okay, after all these years, and is dedicated to the rescuing of little Indian girls from temple prostitution. They use these little girls as prostitutes in the Hindu temple. Okay? I mean, how perverted can you get? But that's what the rest of the world is about, people. You might as well know that right now. These Eastern religions and all of that, don't think we got a lot of religions to choose from and they're all A-okay. No, that's why Jesus said, I am the way and I am the life. Amen. I am everything you need. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. And he says, nobody gets to the Father but by me. It's not going to be by Buddha. It's not going to be by Confucius. It's not going to be by, Muhammad or whatever. Okay? That's all false. She once wrote, isn't it, now this is Amy Carmichael, listen to this, and Cindy had this written in her Bible. Isn't it comforting sometimes to know that his eye, God's eye, sees a cross in something that doesn't look like anything of the sort to us? You know what she's saying? That everything that God sends our way is something God wants to use to draw us closer to himself and keep us in that walk with him. In that journey with him. Do you hear that? Amen? All right. I mean, I've known people who think that ailments, such as both Amy and Cindy had to deal with, that they suffered, that was punishment for sin. And I just say, baloney. That's not true. God is trying to lead his people. He's not trying to slap them down. Amen? But that doesn't mean we don't have difficult things to go through. Paul had a thorn in his flesh, prayed 3 times that it would be taken away. Never was. God was going to use it. Amen? Praise the Lord. I believe they're tests to see if God's still going to get the glory. And not so much that God can see whether or not he's going to get the glory, but for us to see that he's going to get the glory. Amen? That's all part of the journey. Praise the Lord. Amy wrote one other thing she had written in the, and there were several quotes, by the way. I don't have time to put them all in there. Amy wrote, "What thou shalt have words, but at this cost, that thou must first be burned." There's a fire. That's what the boys were asking a little earlier. You know, that's what we're talking about. There's a fire to go through. Amen? And that can involve a lot of different things. That can involve a lot of heavy-duty things, difficult things, hard things. Don't forget that God has it all in his hand. Praise the Lord. You're not going to be thankful for the journey if you don't understand those kinds of things. Amen? Because the journey is going to have those kind of things. Praise God. Burned by red embers from a secret fire, scorched by fire heats and withering winds that sweep through all thy being, carrying thee after from old delights. Doth not the ardent fire consume the mountain's heart before the flow of fervent lava? The one thing we got to hear in all of this is God's got this for everyone. He's got it for all his people. And he's going to use it to draw us all closer to himself. All right. And then I turned a few more pages and I found a quote from Leonard Ravenhill. Now, Leonard Ravenhill was David Wilkerson's mentor. Imagine being David Wilkerson's mentor. Okay? David Wilkerson looked up to him for a lot of years. Okay? And he was obviously older than David. And now they're both gone. But here's what Leonard Ravenhill said. He said, God can't be fully understood, but he can be experienced. I think actually heaven is going to be a whole process of minute by minute and day by day coming to know our God better. Amen? Watchman Nee. This was a quote in there. He wrote, man has not the power to obtain anything more than God has given, but he has the option of taking less. And don't forget something Matthew Henry said, and once again, she had that in her Bible. The proud and the self-sufficient are enemies of the true gospel and of believers. Against such, we must guard. He has rest for the disquieted saints and terror for the presumptuous sinners. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? We'll talk about God's direction, God's mercy. He has rest for the disquieted saints and terror for presumptuous sinners. I think I'd be amiss if I passed over this one, even though it's a little longer. But it's Oswald Chambers. It's a September 20th, if you want to know that. And it's not the whole thing. I don't have room for everything here, but you get the gist. He's in the utmost for his highest, it says, which, by the way, is a world-famous devotional book. If the Spirit of God has transformed you within, you will exhibit divine characteristics in your life, not just good human characteristics. God's life in us expresses itself as God's life and as human life trying to be godly. The secret of the Christian's life is that the supernatural becomes natural in him as a result of God's grace. And the experience of this becomes evident in the practical, everyday details of life. Amen? Now, don't forget, something else was in there by the same fellow, Oswald Chambers, that is. Never seek after anything other than the approval of God. And then I ran across this, a poem. There's no author, so I'm not sure who it is. And when I don't know an author, I just say, to God be the glory. Amen? Because my intention of telling you who wrote it is not to glorify that person, but rather to glorify God, because God is the one who gave it to him. Everybody get that? Amen? All right, here it is. But all through life I see a cross where sons of God yield up their breaths. There is no gain except by loss. There is no life except by death. And no full vision except by faith. Nor glory but by bearing shame. Nor justice but by taking blame. And that eternal passion saith, be emptied of glory and right and name. In other words, the self-life. Be emptied of that. Amen? Next up was I believe this is A.W. Tozer. It wasn't written in there per se, but it was on the very next statement that was in this paper. And you know who Tozer is, of course. He's the great CMA preacher of the last century. But like I said, I'm not real sure it's his. But anyway, glory to God. Amen? Glory to God. Keep about your work that God has given you. Do not flinch because the lion roars. Do not stop to stone the devil's dogs. Do not fool away your time chasing the devil's rabbits. Do your work. Let liars lie. Let corporations resolve. Let the devil do his worst. But see to it that nothing hinders you. Let your aim be as steady as a star. You may be assaulted, insulted, slandered, wounded, and rejected. You may be abused by foes, forsaken by friends, and despised and rejected of men. But see to it with steadfast determination, with unfaltering zeal, praise God, that you pursue the great purpose of your life and object of your being until at last you can say, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. What a life's motto for each and every one of us. Amen? Praise God. Right after that, I came across a bookmark. Okay? And, well, there's two of them that I could say that about, actually. There's this cardboard one. Okay? Which is a prayer list. Once again, about as big as a book. Okay, but then there's this one. And where is it here? Ah, there it is. And this is one Lily made for her. Got a whale on it. See that? I'm guessing maybe Jonah's whale. And then all these M's flying around, as Ben calls them, right? Probably seagulls. Okay, the sun and everything. Whales going along right on top of the waves. Anyway, and then it just says at the bottom, bookmark. Okay? Praise God. And Lily used a hard C to write that. B-O-O-C, book. M-A-R-C, mark. Amen? Way to go, Lily. Okay, and that's, how long ago did you give this to her, Lily? I'm guessing years ago. In the early part of your life. Right? Okay, and she's held on to it for all this time. Praise the Lord. Okay. There's in that list of people to be praying for, there are several young children from the oncology floor at Pittsburgh's Children's Hospital. We came to know them when Lily was there for her treatments for about 9 months. Two more bookmarks. There's another one that Lily gave her, and it says on the front, "You are special," and then it's got Ephesians 1, verse 16. Okay, 1 verse 16. And I can't stop thanking God. I can't stop thanking God. And it says it's from Lily on the back, and it's got a picture of a puppy, of course. What else would it be? Alright? Praise the Lord. Kara, is this a poem you wrote that she kept in her Bible? It's called The Warrior? It isn't? Let me read it anyway. "This morning my thoughts traveled along to a place in my life where days have long gone, beholding an image of what I used to be as vision stirred and God spoke to me. He showed me a warrior, a soldier in place, positioned by heaven, yet I saw not the face. I watched as the warrior fought enemies that came from the darkness with destruction for me. I saw as the warrior would dry away tears as all the heaven's angels hovered so near. I saw many wounds on the warrior's face, yet weapons of warfare were firmly in place. I felt my heart weeping, my eyes held so much as God let me feel the warrior's prayer. I thought how familiar the words that were prayed, the prayers were like lightning that would never fade. I said to God, praise the warrior's name. He gave me no reply. He chose to refrain. I asked, Lord, who is broken that they may need such a prayer? He showed me an image of myself standing there. Bound by confusion, lost and alone, I felt prayers of the warrior carry me home. I asked, please show me, Lord, this warrior too, so true. I watched and wept for mother, the warrior was you. And then, there's a bookmark I gave. Now, I didn't write this. It's right there in the front. My wonderful wife, as I look back on the road we've traveled together as a couple, I'm so thankful God has allowed me to share this journey with you. You have been my soulmate, my best friend, who has been there through highs and lows and loving me each step of the way. Lastly, I just want to mention, like I said, I can't cover everything, but I just want to give you a feel of how amazing our God is. What he will do for you, what he did for her, what he will do for all. Okay? Praise God. All right. There are hundreds, I haven't counted them, but there are at least hundreds, maybe thousands of Greek and Hebrew definitions sprinkled throughout her margins. We can be all thankful for all of it. But one word in particular jumps out at me. One one particular definition. It was written on a little piece of paper and stuck to the rear cover. And it comes from Matthew 5, verse 1. Blessed are the pure in spirit. That might be verse 2, come to think of it. Anyway, blessed are the pure in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the pure in spirit. Now, in a day when so many equate this blessedness to just being happy, you know, for example, Robert Schuller came out with a book, you know, Happy Attitudes, you know, and it was a book on the Beatitudes, but he translated all as happier they that do this, happier they that are that, or whatever. It's not happy. Okay? I mean, let's get to the Bible. You know what I mean? How are we going to go on the journey if we won't watch every step that we're supposed to be taking? In the original Greek, it's makurios. Okay? It means to be characterized. This is the definition, people. This is not just happy. Okay? The quality of God to be fully set and to be fully satisfied, not due to circumstances, but due to Christ's indwelling. It is not static, but progressive, and depends on the fulfillment of conditions set down by the Word of God. Amen? Which is what? The Bible. Amen? That's God's book. Praise God. That's how He leads us. That and prayer and godly counsel is how He leads us. Amen? Now we've got to ask ourselves, are we feeling thankful yet? I hope you came to this place feeling thankful. You know, I hope it's not just something that happens when I tell you something, okay? But we need to be thankful all the time. Amen? Have a thankful spirit, a thankful heart, and just be blown away, so to speak. Maybe that's not a good way to put it. But just totally immersed in an understanding of how much our God loves us. Do we get that? Amen? Isn't that kind of what Paul was saying? You know, we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, in the prayer lists that you have stuck on an inside page or wherever you might have it, or in a separate notebook, you know, like I gave you all those notebooks to be using them for praying for this devotional book, being written, and once it's written, who's going to be changed by it? Glory be to God. Amen? To wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. Glory to God. Amen? Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, I want to thank You, dear God, for the truth that's been laid out here. It's not a truth for anyone over anybody else. No, Lord, this is what You have for all Your people. And I want to thank You for it, dear God. So we exalt You and we lift You up and we need You, dear God, in this very day. Hallelujah. We need You, dear God, to lead us and guide us in the ways of everlasting life. Thank You, Jesus. Help us, Lord, to grow in this thankfulness over these next several weeks as we progress closer and closer to what we call in this country Thanksgiving Day. For a lot of people, it's about just football games or turkeys or any of those things. And I have no problem with turkey. Praise the Lord. But dear God, it's much more than that. Much more. Seeing how great our God is and knowing how much we need Him and being thankful. Praise the Lord. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah.